immigration, Heather. That's Bourne. Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is March 20th, 2017, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All on this special Monday edition. We are usually on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday, now at 6 o'clock p.m., 9 p.m., 6 o'clock p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern on the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, which now runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And you can listen to the live stream on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives, including the new ones, immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are always happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or you can reach us via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for all one word. You can also check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and get all our other contact information if you want to send us an email, or if you want to go in the chat room on Spreaker, you can do that as well and ask questions. But at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, we have links to all of our social media pages, including Facebook, Twitter, as well as original articles / blogs, and all of the contact information, the show phone number, the Skype username, if you forget any of that, just go to NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and you can get all of that there, along with the original articles, including a series on the drug war and why we can't go back to how drugs were in 1914. Where essentially before 1914, everything was totally legal. That's the first time that the U.S. government actually tried, that I'm aware of, tried to tell people what they can put in their body and what they can possess. Now, there might have been other minor things before that, but not that I'm aware of. So tonight, we're going to talk about things we've talked about in the past, but organize it into the basics of government and what government really is. Not just my opinion of what government really is, but also a bunch of facts along with that. Now, yes, part of it is going to be my opinion as well, but there also are facts that, of course, the government doesn't talk about. They don't bring up. Government schools don't bring up. But they are facts and they do exist. For example, the government extorts money from you without your consent. They call it taxes. Now, if you look up the definition of extortion, fuck, that's the one out of all the definitions. I have a few definitions. I didn't look up extortion, but I pretty much know it by heart, not the technical definition. But what extortion is, I'll paraphrase, is threatening somebody and telling them that if they don't give you what you want, you will hurt them in some way. Whether it's break their legs or kill them. It's what the mafia did. So when it comes to taxes, the government ultimately uses the threat of violence and the threat of force to get you to pay your taxes. If you don't file a tax return, that is a criminal offense, not filing a tax return. Now, if you file a tax return but don't pay your taxes, it's a little different than just not filing a tax return. However, eventually there's force somewhere, because in that case, they'd say, well, you owe us money, even though you really don't, but they have enough men with weapons behind them to enforce that. And they could ultimately go to your employer and get it that way. But now they're forcing your employer. They're blackmailing your employer. They're telling them that they'll shut them down. And they'll shut them down forcefully. Because what if they continue to operate their business and they say, no, we're not going to garnish your wages. And we're not going to discontinue our operation. The point being, without getting into too much detail in that example, because I want to get into detail when we get into everything, is that even though you may think that somewhere along the line there's no force involved, that is not the case. There is always force, or the threat of force. It most of the time doesn't come to force because people are too scared. So it's that threat of force that causes people or pushes them to do things that they may not normally do. Now, you have a whole bunch of people that feel that it's their duty to pay taxes, and it's not, but whatever. So you have those people as well. I'm not saying that if the government didn't have any punishment where it was voluntary, that if you didn't pay your taxes, nothing happened, that nobody would pay their taxes. I bet you the majority of people wouldn't pay their taxes. But you have people that think there's some kind of duty to pay your taxes. I bet you those people wouldn't even fucking pay them, though. They go around saying that shit, but I bet they wouldn't pay them. So anyway, what we're going to talk about today is really what government really is. And we're going to talk about some of the facts, and then some of my opinions that are based upon the facts. I also want to talk about a couple other things during the show. There were, I believe, let me validate this. I have the website up. There were what was it, 6 people killed by the police yesterday. Yeah, yesterday, March 19th. One of them, a 21-year-old pregnant woman, who the police claim was either used as like a shield, or what I think is that the police shot her. Now, whether they shot her by accident or on purpose, that's a whole nother story. But they definitely had total disregard for her safety and protection in serving. It was a SWAT team that served a warrant. And what did they serve it for? I'll let you guess. What do you think? Drugs. Because drug busts are more important than people's lives, of course, because the police make money off them, number one. And really, I talked about this on the Cops shows that I did based on the show Cops, which I want to talk about that as well, because I saw an episode of Cops today after I got home. And, you know, if it wasn't for drugs being illegal, they wouldn't have much to do at all. And then if you take, you know, put guns into the mix as far as your right to defend yourself and your right to possess a gun, there's nothing. Never mind the Second Amendment, but even if you want to go that fucking route, and I'm saying never mind the Second Amendment because you have a right as a person to defend yourself and possess whatever you want. So you don't need a fucking piece of paper to tell you that. But even if you go by the Second Amendment, if you're a Second Amendment supporter, which I'm not saying I'm not, I support the Second Amendment because it helps to keep the ability of people that can pass background checks, guns, even though I don't believe in background checks. So, I mean, I support it. And obviously it's necessary because if it wasn't for that, the government would just take guns from everybody, which they're trying to do anyway. But what I'm saying is that's not where your right comes from. You have the right to defend yourself. It's a basic fucking right. And we'll talk about that when we talk about government. I mean, basically what we're going to talk about today is the kind of going back to the basics when it comes to government and why government shouldn't exist. And not only why government shouldn't exist, but why it is a violent, coercive entity that violates the rights of all people. Not just some people, all people. So, there's so many thoughts and things that I have to talk about regarding this. Hopefully I won't miss anything. I obviously, when I do the show, I put together an outline. I've talked about this before because you don't want to do a radio show, obviously, and script your show. I think that, I mean, maybe some people do that. You'd have to be a pretty good actor, I think, to do it. But I do outlines to make sure I cover certain points and whatever. But hopefully I won't miss out on anything that I want to talk about. So starting at the beginning, and this is starting at the beginning of the U.S. government, I don't think I've done enough in the study of governments in general. And when I say that, I'm talking about especially, you know, going back to, you know, ancient civilizations and stuff like that. I mean, I took class. Well, I didn't specifically, I think, take an ancient civilizations class, but, you know, we went over that, and probably the last time we went over all that for me was like sixth grade. So, and I still remember a lot of the stuff. We went over the ancient Egyptians, the ancient Greeks, ancient Romans. Of course, there's stuff they left out. I don't think they got a lot into the Ottoman Empire, but I can't remember. It was a long time ago. And, you know, other stuff. You know, and then, of course, the what wouldn't be called ancient civilizations, but the empires after Christ. And I only say after Christ is because that's how they base the fucking years. And it's really retarded if the calendar year wise, because they go like backwards and then go to the year zero. So it's like, I don't know. It's just fucked up because obviously at the time they weren't like going backwards. I don't know how they kept years before Christ, but, or even during, because they didn't, it wasn't until after. I don't know if they went back. I don't, that's something that I'm honestly not familiar with. This is something that Ken Chorjan, who comes on the show every other Wednesday, would probably know about, as he's a historian. But I don't know how they kept track of the year when you go back to, you know, before Christ died or whatever. But anyway, so I'm going to kind of keep my discussion specifically to the U.S. government, but this applies to all governments as far as I'm concerned, the concept of government. So I'm talking about the concept of government, but it's like I'm using the U.S. as my example, because I believe the concept of government in itself is about control, power, and money, and controlling everyone and everything. So if I had to say, what is government? Now, that's not a fact. That's my opinion. But, and I'm not going to go and say that on everything. Obviously, you know, you can determine what's fact and what's opinion based on what I'm saying. But if it's something that it's hard to differentiate, I'll say that, you know, that's a fact. But I believe, you know, what when you look at what government is, it's subjective. It's not a, I guess, black and white, no pun intended there, definition of what is government. Now, you can go with like a textbook definition, because all governments are, not all, but pretty much, I mean, there's no two governments that are exactly the same. They may use the same form of government. But so you could say there are similar types of governments. Like if I said, what is democracy? There is a specific definition as to what democracy is by definition. Now, that doesn't mean that a country that calls itself a democracy is actually a democracy. You know, the definition of a democracy is that either through representatives or a direct democracy, people have a vote and a say, quote unquote say, because you really don't, but that's the textbook definition. But you have a say by voting over the laws and what happens within government. Now, based on that definition, you know, the United States is not a democracy, nor supposedly it's a republic. And the republic, see, a lot of these definitions, and I don't even really need to go into them because they don't really apply to what I'm going to talk about, except maybe an oligarchy. But you have the People's Republic of China. You have the Democratic, I forget the exact name, but North Korea is like the People's Democratic something. It has democracy or democratic in it. So you can name it whatever you want or call it whatever you want. It doesn't mean it operates that way. But supposedly, the quote-unquote founding fathers were a democratic republic, or I guess you could just call it a republic, in that, yes, people had votes and quote-unquote say. And I'm saying quote-unquote because you don't have much say when you have one vote and there's millions of people. I'm sorry, you just don't. And unless you live in a small town and you're voting for like your city council within your little small town, you don't have much of a say or can make much of an impact, period. Certain people can, but the federal government has gone so far that they're even getting involved in counties. I mean, they're very involved in Clark County, which is the county that Las Vegas is in. And I've talked about this before, and how they get involved is money. They try to control as many states and counties as possible and cities based on money. If you do this, we'll give you money. We'll give you grants for this. And I've talked about this before, and I haven't looked at it in a while because I kind of got a little away from the actual political side because it just fucking pissed me off. But I still need to know at least what's going on, because then I know, okay, what direction their plan is going. So I still follow it. Not to the extent that I did, because I was really into following all of these things for that reason, to see what their actual plan, or not what their plan is, because I believe their plan is to take total control, but how they're doing it. So in one case, it's all of these grants, you know, looking at the Clark County budget a couple years ago, more than half of it is federal grant money. And you look at where they're getting the grant money, you know, whether they're getting it in law enforcement, they're getting it in housing and urban development from HUD. And that means a lot because they have to meet certain circumstances. So they don't just give away money, the federal government. The federal government gives away money with specific stipulations. So if you want money from HUD to build affordable housing or to build certain things, you have to meet certain criteria. The money has to be used in a certain way. And that's how they control a lot of things. I remember even for something like the blood alcohol level. So Nevada didn't want to lower the blood alcohol level for obvious reasons. You have a town that, not just a town, but a state, really, even though there's not much between Las Vegas and Reno. But you do have Vegas and Reno, which are very big gambling towns. Of course, Vegas is the number one in probably the world. I know Macau's getting built up, and a lot of the casinos that own casinos in Las Vegas also are getting involved in Macau. And you have Atlantic City, but it's not as big as Vegas. But you also have Reno, which calls itself the biggest little city in the country or something, which I've been to Reno, and it's nice, and it's you know, it's pretty big, at least for the gambling side of it. You know, if you're comparing the Strip to Reno, of course, the Strip is a lot more luxurious and bigger, and, you know, you'll always find people there. And Reno's a little smaller and not as populated as far as... The city's not as populated, but, I mean, you know, the casinos aren't as packed as say, the Strip. But it's still relevant, and it still generates a lot of revenue for the state. So, being that it was at Party Town, and I don't give a fuck what anybody says, and I know this from experience, unfortunately, and it's past experience. I haven't drank in, I think it's 2.5 years now. I know when, because it was on my birthday, the last time I drank, and I know the year. So it's been about 2.5 years now. And in the past 3 years, because I know this because of the show, I think that was the only time I drank. So in like 3 years, I drank once or whatever. Not because I felt that I needed to stop drinking. I just didn't like it anymore. I got to a point where maybe it was that I got older, or, I mean, not that that means something if you're, I mean, people drink their whole lives, but the whole going out and getting drunk or whatever, and I don't want to go into too much detail, not because I'm embarrassed or that I don't want to share things with the audience. It's because I know that the show's being recorded and downloaded, and I even had noticed that, you know, every show was downloaded in a town right outside D.C. where they have a lot of government offices. Now, that could have just been coincidence. Either way, we know the CIA now, along with the NSA, is collecting all our data and could use it against us later, especially a show like this, which is anti-government. So, there's certain things, you know, I'll come out and say my opinions, but as far as my personal life, which I've gotten more into as the show has gone along, as I mentioned, it will be 3 years next month that I've been doing the show, because I think to do a show, you have to have, not that I have the greatest personality, but people have to be into you personally as well. I mean, they're making a personal investment of their time, and you have to share certain things, I think, with the audience. So I've shared more and more with the audience as time has went on. I think at the beginning, you know, I didn't share that much, but I realize I'm sharing, you know, I'm putting stuff out there that can never be taken back. It's out on the internet. It's out there. So there's not really anything that I've done that, as far as from a legal standpoint, that I have to worry about. But there's just things that it's just not good to have out there because of government. And you never know what they'll do with information. Now, again, it's nothing illegal, but, you know, like, for example, I'm not, but if I used to, and this is just an example, if when I was younger, I smoked crack for 5 or 6 years or something, it's not something I'm going to say on the air, and it's not going to help me with getting jobs neither. Now, for me, fortunately, I avoided all that. You know, I've admitted that I've tried marijuana before. I can probably count the amount of times I've done it. And I've even said that I sold it in high school. And, you know, I've admitted that as well. But as far as doing other drugs, I've never done anything. And I've talked about I have a pain issue or have had pain issues. So I've taken, you know, pain medication, but I go to a doctor as well. So that is a little different. You could still call that, well, you know, taking drugs, but, you know, under a doctor's supervision. So besides that, and of course, alcohol, and I did, this is where I don't want to get into too much detail, but I did have times in my life, I guess, where I drank a lot. And that's kind of how we got to this point. I don't remember how I got to this point, but how I haven't drank really in 2.5 years. But there's been points in my life where, you know, when I was younger, where I drank a lot. But I don't think that it has anything to do with maturity or anything like that. I think maybe the going out partying and getting wasted does, like going to a club and, you know, getting drunk or whatever. But, you know, you can drink your whole life and, you know, that doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean you're, doesn't mean anything. But I totally forgot what my point was, leading how I led up to that. But as far as it relates to, or getting back to, I guess, government. And I forgot the last thing I actually said about government before I got into talking about alcohol. But when you're talking about the goal, okay, I was talking about, I'm sorry, the budget for Nevada and how government's trying to control stuff. And I know how I got into it. So the legal limit, and I said I knew this from experience, that the legal limit used to be 1 point something. It might have just been 1.0. But at one point, I don't even think there was one. See, people, that's another thing that the government hides from people as good as they can. It's the hiding in plain view. There's so much stuff that they hide in plain view, and you say, well, if they're hiding it, how can you hide something in plain view? Well, it's there, but nobody talks about it because most people don't know, and the school system or government media or any of those don't talk about it. So they don't talk about the history of DUI and how that even came up in the first place. And we've talked about it on the show. And I knew a little about it, but Ken Shorgen, who I had mentioned earlier, who's on every other week, check him out at thedailyeconomist.com. We, on one show, it had come up for some reason about, you know, a woman's son died, you know, in a car accident. I don't know if he was drinking or the other people were drinking, and started this group. And of course, what happens is that none of these groups, I don't give a fuck what anybody says, even back then, and this is partial opinion, but it's opinion based on fact. And Black Lives Matter, you could take as an example, and this is a fact, that Black Lives Matter was funded by millionaires with it, or billionaires with an agenda. And you can tell by reading their platform that it was not just written by these Black Lives Matter groups, because it had a whole bunch of shit in there that is part of the progressive agenda. And it didn't have much to do with police neither. So that's why, that's my fucking issue with them. I have a huge issue with Black Lives Matter, and it has nothing to do with the fact that they, obviously, you know, I've made my opinion very clear on police. I don't think they should fucking exist, and that would take care of any racism, because if they didn't exist, then they couldn't be racist. But it had nothing to do with them being called Black Lives Matter. I mean, they could have been whoever. My issue was they were funded by a progressive, or not by a, by progressive political operatives. And the whole thing was like a psyop or a planned out thing. And I'm not going to get into that because I've talked about it on other shows. And most people are afraid to criticize Black Lives Matter. Not so much anymore, but they were. But the criticism that other people are giving it is about the cops and this and that. And that's how we got into this whole thing of no one criticizes the cops anymore for all the bad shit they're doing. And I'm not just talking about racism, because the cops, I believe, are in general, a racist organization. I don't even know if I'd say racist organization, although I have said that in the past. I think they're more of a discriminatory organization, meaning that, which is worse, because if you're racist and you don't act out on it, people can be racist and not actually it make a difference. And I mean that in, if you don't bring racism into the workplace, and you don't attack people, and you just, you know, don't hang around a certain race because you're racist, and you sit in your house and say racist shit or whatever, that's your right, and really it doesn't affect anything. Now, people that actually act on their racism, that's discrimination. That's where, and that's where the police, I believe, look at a lot of black or young, not just black kids, but I call them kids, but even in their 20s and whatever, and even black people older, and look at them all as criminals. And that's where I think things are happening. Like, oh, they're criminals, they must have guns, and police are fucking pussies, and they just shoot them. I don't know that it's an actual hate for black people. It may be hate for, you know, people that are involved in the hip hop culture or things like that. I don't look at that as a strictly black thing, although it was created by black people. But just black people in general, police view them as criminals. Now, I'm not saying, and this, that's a generality, it's not every cop views every black person as a criminal. I'm just saying that's what I think happened or continues to happen, and nothing is going to change, especially, you know, with the current president. And even if you had another, even if Hillary was in there, it's the same thing. They all support law enforcement. They're all puppets. They're all controlled. We'll get to that later in the show. But anyway, so they forced Nevada to lower their DUI minimum, or whatever you want to call it, the blood alcohol level, from, I believe it was 0.01, but I think even years before that, it was even higher than that, which I don't have a problem with. I don't particularly think that DUI should even be a crime, because it's pre-crime. It's before you've done anything. The fact of you drinking and being beyond a level that they have arbitrarily come up with that they keep trying to lower so they can, you know, fuck with you, because 0.08 is nothing. And people can drive fine at 0.08, most people. And the fact that they arrest people for that, I think, is fucked up. Now, if you hit somebody, then, you know, that's different. Or if you kill somebody. But the fact of just being over the limit that they came up with reminds me of things like age of consent is, you know, an arbitrary number, 18, you're an adult. You know, what if you're 17 and 10 months? I mean, it's just whatever. What if you're 0.081? And I'm sorry, it was 0.10 because right now it's 0.08. So anyway, they told them if they didn't change it, and this is recently, and when I mean recently, I don't mean like this year, but I mean it's been in the past 10 years or something. But they forced them to do that because they caved to the money. Just like Common Core, all the states, I don't even think they looked at it. They just said, oh, the money. So the same way that, you know, everybody else caves to money, the government is, well, of course, the government's all about money. That's one of their pillars, in my opinion, of the what government is, or one of their goals. But the point being is that they're able to control states through money. And, you know, I don't know the specifics on how they tax the states, because they do, and then how it gets distributed, because I've heard, you know, the conversations on, okay, well, this state pays in this amount of taxes but ends up getting more. So it's turned in really into a federal thing when it comes to where really it shouldn't be, maybe a couple things. And that's if you believe in government. I have to, it's hard to talk about government when you don't think it should exist. So that's if, you know, you believe in government, that the states should be not only be responsible for the majority of things, but not have to pay the majority of their money to the federal government. I mean, besides maybe the highway system, you know, off the top of my head, and there may be a couple things that rationally you can rationalize and say, well, the state should be helping to pay for this. But besides that, I don't see anything else. And that's the problem, that states can't sustain themselves. But I think part of the reason why, I think some states can, but it's getting where no state can sustain themselves without money from the federal government, that they, I mean, that was done on purpose so the government can control the states. Because if they didn't need the money, they could just tell the federal government to fuck off and be able to sustain themselves. But obviously they need the money. And they may need the money. One of the reasons is because the amount of money that the federal government is taking from the states. Now, I don't know what percentage and what they tax or whatever. You know, if they take a percentage of their sales tax, or, you know, I know there's federal there's federal taxes that are collected, but I think a lot of those are paid directly by, say, businesses. But if it's paid, you know, if the business, say, for gas stations has to pay a certain amount to the federal government, that's money that's not going to the states, and that's money that the state is not going to up the gas tax or as much because it's already high because of federal government, like things like that. So the interference of the federal government in the tax system would take money away from the states. Now, again, I don't know the specifics on that, so I can't comment. But getting to the basics of government, I believe that government has one main goal and one main purpose. Now, the U.S. government, at least in its creation, the only purpose of government was to protect the rights of its quote-unquote citizens, because the word citizen is meaningless. You really don't get any benefits. You can live here, I guess, and work here. As far as, you know, any thing that the government gives you or what being a citizen really means, I mean, to me, it doesn't mean anything except that you can live, but you can live here as a resident too and work. So it's more of a negative than a positive, I would say, especially at this point. Now, unfortunately, there's no place else to go because the whole world has been taken over by governments, which are essentially gangs or cults, even. I mean, a government has become almost a cult to a certain extent, and I'll get into that at some point. But it's definitely like a giant mafia is really what it is. And it's funny because on the show The Walking Dead, which I always thought was more of a status type show, although, I mean, it still is, but there are some things going on that address this a little. And we'll have to see how they turn out at the end of the season. I guess there's only two episodes left this season. Anyway, so I believe from the beginning that this was the plan. That the plan was over generations. And I believe from the standpoint of if you want to control a nation and you're that patient, I believe that it was a pretty smart plan. But I also think that not everybody that was involved with creating the government, the U.S. government, was involved. But if you look up the definition of government, the first line, or the first, you know, it has multiple definitions, but the first line on most dictionaries is the act or process of governing specifically authoritative direction or control. It always has control in it. Another is the office, authority, or function of governing. Authority is another one that's in many of the definitions. So essentially, when you're looking at the U.S. government, but you can apply this to any government, they had no authority. Nobody does. Nobody has the authority to create a government, to rule over people, or to tell other people what to do, or to take money from them without their permission, to force things on them without their permission. Nobody does. Larkin Rose said it best when he said, "You don't have rights that I don't have." So if you have those rights, then I have those rights. And then you get into confliction, because if you say, okay, well, everybody has the right to make, you know, tell other people what to do, obviously you can't do that. So nobody has the right to tell anybody what to do. Now, of course, we'll get into, you know, natural law and interfering with other people's freedom. But with the exception of that, no one has any authority to tell anybody what to do, to start a government, to control people's lives, any of it, without their consent. Now, in the, and I'm not a scholar on the formation of the country, but I know enough, they technically overthrew the government, sort of. They kind of followed what was said in the Articles of Confederation to install a new government, but they didn't have the right to install the Articles of Confederation or the Constitution for that matter, because not everybody signed the Articles of Confederation or the Constitution. And the Constitution, a lot of it was done in secret. Certain people were kept out of it. They did it in a slimy way. And that's to get more control. That's what it was about, that they didn't have enough control. The federal government didn't have enough control over the states under the Articles of Confederation. So they installed the Constitution. But my point is that from the beginning, the ultimate goal was to control every aspect of everybody's life, as well as to control every aspect of everything, along with money and power as well, of course. And that, now I know historians obviously disagree with me at what point that became the plan. And a lot of people will say, you know, after World War II or after the Civil War or whenever. But I don't believe that. Governments, and I'll tell you why, because governments inherently, that's what they are. And this is a fact, whether it's the intent of the people that created the government or not, but governments are there to, quote unquote, keep the people in line and to control the society. Now, the level of control depends on that society and that government. But the fact remains that government is there for the purposes of control. And you can't deny that. Now, they, of course, say it's to protect the rights of people. And that's just a bullshit, you know, propaganda, because, yeah, that sounds great. We have government to protect our rights. Does it do that? Well, it definitely doesn't do that now. Did it do that at any time? Doesn't seem like it, because, I mean, I'm sure there's a certain incidences where somebody's rights were being violated, and the police helped. I'm saying in the history of the country, probably not very often. but usually it's the other way around. They're the ones violating your rights, the government and the police. So from the beginning, and the difference, and I always bring this up, is that instead of just from the beginning or later, if you want to argue that they didn't believe that in the beginning, that they, instead of just totally taking over, they kept people in the illusion of freedom and made them comfortable enough where they wouldn't stand up and fight back. And they were willing to do it over generations. And the other thing as well is that that illusion of freedom and not going after everybody. So, for example, somebody had said to me before, oh, well, obviously we don't live in a police state because you can do your show. And that's just bullshit. Because to me, we live in a police state because of what the police can do and what they have done. It doesn't mean they have to do it to every person. So they do that on purpose, that they allow people, a lot of people that they, you know, are meaningless or whatever. Not to say my life is meaningless, but I mean, not enough people listen to me. I don't make any impact in general. I mean, in the big scheme of things, I don't make an impact, and it doesn't really matter. And there's even people that are more important that they don't go after, because then people can point to that and say, well, look, you know, he gets away with doing all this shit and they don't go after him. So it makes people think that, oh, yeah, well, obviously we don't live in a police state and we have rights and freedoms. But how do we have rights and freedoms when they can do that anytime they want? And they have. I mean, they've had people killed. They've had journalists killed. They spy on you. They do whatever they want. They just pick and choose who to do it to because they want to keep that illusion of freedom. They did it in a way where, as I was saying, instead of having a dictator, they said, look, we're going to do this smart, where we're going to make people think they're free. And at the same time, we don't want to just do this as a takeover and have people resent it and be against it. We want to convince people this is how fucked up the U.S. government is. But we want to convince, now I believe all governments want the same things, to ultimately control everything. It's, but they go about it differently. But we want to be able to have the people love their enslavement, that actually go along with the policies that take away their rights. And they're starting to. Not that they're starting to now. I mean, they've been doing this for a while, more and more as the years go on. And I look at it like a staircase, you know, one step at a time. And I believe the minute the government was formed, they started. And it started slowly. And, I mean, you can go back to what Washington did, Shays' Rebellion. You can look at Lincoln and all the rights that he violated during the Civil War. And I'm sure there's so much more if we were to go and get all the documents that we could, and probably a lot of them are available, but I don't know how they were doing things, if they were doing cables back, you know, with the first 10 or 15 presidents. You know, and of course, their technology was nothing compared to what we have now. But that there's a lot of other things that either we don't know or are hiding in plain sight, and I'm just not aware of, that was done when people thought, oh, no, things are, you know, they were free until this time. Like, you always have people that think things just got the way they did in the past 20 or 30 years, and that's just such bullshit. You know, you can go back to a lot of moments in time. You know, definitely in the early 1900s with the Federal Reserve Act and the income tax. And like I said, even with Washington. So, and even, you know, switching the Articles of Confederation to the Constitution. What was that about? That was about power. So I believe right away they started the plan, and they, the powers that be, the elite. You even look at the Constitution was for the elite. It wasn't for women. It wasn't for black people. It wasn't even for people that didn't own property. Really. So it was for rich, elite white men, white Protestant men, really. When everybody as a human being has the right to true freedom and liberty. Now, what they do with that, that's their choice and that's their decision. You're not owed anything when you're born, except, you know, you're not owed rights. You just have them because nobody has to do anything to give them to you. They just have to not do certain things to violate them. But on that note, we're going to take a quick break, and or maybe longer than a quick break, but play some clips related to what we're talking about. I definitely want to play the why libertarianism is so dangerous, which I've played so many times, but this is so important, I think, to the discussion that I'm having and what I'm explaining, because this is a lot of what it is and what has gone on. Done in a neatly put together by Brett Vanat of the School Sucks Project or podcast. And it's one of my favorite videos, actually. I told Brett that. He still didn't come on my show. He said he was probably going to come on, and but I'm sure he got caught up in other things, and I never asked him again because I didn't want to bother him. But anyway, that doesn't mean I don't like the video. I'm not that. There's those people that if they get mad at you, it's fucked up. Like, I'm not mad at him. I think he either didn't want to come on the show because he heard it and didn't like it, but I doubt that because there's a lot of people that came on that, you know, are friendly with him and came on his show or whatever. But probably just forgot and got caught up in other things and whatever. So no, I'm not mad or anything, but I'm saying there are people that when they are mad, you know, if they like something, they're like, I don't like this anymore. It sucks. I'm not one of those people. If I like something that you did, no matter how I feel about you, I'm still gonna like that and say, you know, yeah, I fucking don't like that person, but I still give them credit for what they did. Like Howard Stern, for example, where I'm not a Howard Stern fan anymore for a lot of reasons. And although he said some positive shit regarding guns, so that was pretty good. But I'm not a, although I still think he's funny, I'm not a, a fan anymore, but I still give him his due that he's one of the, probably the best broadcaster ever, and the innovation. And I mean, he's helped all radio people in general. Not only that, I mean, he's helped all mediums, really, in what he did. He challenged that line, you know, of how far you can go. And TV was able to do stuff later because of it, and other media as well. So, but anyway, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. If you'd like to call in, you can get the number there, or you can get it from me right now for 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or you can contact us via Skype, username nonpartisanlibertyforall. All one word. What else would it be? So again, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Check out some of our articles. Like us on Facebook. We actually have 4 Facebook pages. Like us on Twitter, or I guess you don't. Is it liking somebody on Twitter, or is it just subscribing or whatever? Follow us on Twitter. Follow us on Spreaker. Follow us all over the place. There's a bunch of listings there. So anyway, we'll be back right after this. We're going to talk more about government, and time permitting, we'll talk about the police story I mentioned, and a little about the show Cops as well. So we'll be back after these important clips. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Hi, my name is Brett, and I'm currently recovering from a dangerous and extreme belief system. A belief system that if I had not taken action, most likely would have landed me in jail or even a mental institution. This belief system has many names, but it is most often referred to as libertarianism. For years, I would frighten ordinary people with long rants about the non-aggression principle. That's the central ethical stance in libertarianism, which asserts that the initiation of physical force against persons or property, or the threat of such force, is inherently illegitimate, regardless of what kind of excuses somebody makes up to aggress. I know, when I hear myself say it out loud today, I realize how crazy I once was. But I've made a lot of progress. Through my exposure to new points of view and sources of information, I've realized that I was being just too optimistic about the huge group of people who live their lives peacefully and mind their own business, and too cynical about the tiny group of people who disregard these utopian notions of non-aggression, property rights, and self-ownership in order to keep us safe and maintain stability. Even though a lot of the time it does seem like they have no problem treating our communities and the entire planet like their own personal f***ing whoa. I'm sorry. Still trying to let go of some of this negative imagery. Like I said, recovery is a process. But it wasn't just the flaws in libertarian thinking, it was also the dangers. This occurred to me one day when somebody who lives in the real world asked me the question, what would you do if you woke up tomorrow and government was gone? I had never thought about it before, and at that point a terrifying worst case scenario started to play out in my mind. And before I was even halfway through this imaginative what-if scenario, things got so dark that I was forced to swear off the philosophy of liberty for good. Because of the difficult economic situation, we would have to assume that there would be a significant spike in property crime, theft, and looting. Now, libertarians might try to argue that property owners would demand protection services and somebody would quickly rise up to meet that demand. But I think things would be a little too chaotic for that. Now, imagine this. A sudden and enormous increase in violence. The first kind of violence would be property owners trying to defend what is theirs, which libertarians would argue, rightfully so, that they have a right to do. But friends, this is a worst-case scenario. So, there would also be a rise in violent crime in furtherance of theft, and things would quickly spin even more out of control. Now, libertarians might again argue at this point that whatever violence or theft is taking place would be far less than what the state was carrying out the very day before. But don't worry, my fellow non-libertarians, I'm about to make this scenario much, much worse, in my imagination. Even if most people turned out to be peaceful and capable of rational thought and recognized that violence is totally impractical, there's always going to be bad people. And they would have decided, for whatever reason, that they were going to continue going around and enacting random violence on whoever they want to get whatever they need. Now, at this point, again, the libertarian would chime in and say those kinds of thugs would be drastically outnumbered by peaceful and cooperative people. But in the worst-case scenario, these violent actors wouldn't stop just because they were outnumbered. They would band together. They would carry out their violence in predation against the people in groups to increase their chances of success. And what we would have over time, maybe it would take a few weeks, maybe it would take a few months, maybe even a few years, groups of these violent marauders going around, finding communities filled with peaceful and productive people, getting along and living their lives, and they would go in and kill them all and take their stuff. And I can already hear the libertarians saying that is so stupid. If these violent marauders killed all the productive people, they would die off themselves. Since they don't know how to do anything besides violence, they would eventually starve or run out of resources. And that would be the end of it. But I'm one step ahead of you. See, over time, we have to assume that the marauders, the thugs, would get smarter. And after several bands of these thugs had died from starvation or lack of resources because they killed all the people who knew how to do and get all the stuff, they would realize that when they raid a village, they have to leave some productive people alive so they can come back later and take the new stuff that they made. And over time, they would actually develop even more subtle and efficient methods of exploiting their victims. Instead of roaming around or periodically going back to a village and killing more people and taking more stuff, sooner or later, they would just move in and live amongst the productive people. See, in the worst case scenario, they would be really diabolical. Instead of all this back and forth, surprise, here we are again, within a few years, people would just be used to them. And they would also get used to the fact that when they want to, these thugs are going to take their stuff. Maybe rough them up a little bit. It's getting pretty bad, isn't it, libertarians? Well, guess what? It gets worse. From the darkest corners of my fear-filled imagination comes this idea. What if these thugs, these predators, were so clever that eventually they realized that their little system could continue unabated if they just bribed the people? You see, after the thugs took everything they wanted for themselves and gave whatever they wanted to their friends, what if they just took whatever was left and offered it as kind of like a kickback to the productive people in the community? We are your masters. But if you tolerate that, maybe once in a while we'll throw up a new building here or a new bridge over there, some pavement down over there. So why don't we just continue along with this little arrangement, because as you already know, we are really awesome at violence. And if you don't agree, we can still just kill you. Remember, like how we used to do. I know this all sounds sick, but these kinds of people are out there, libertarians. You're gonna have to face that. You know what else? If they were really clever, they would scare the people into compliance. Not with their own violence all the time, but they could actually threaten the people with the violence of other gangs. They could say, hey, you know, yeah, we might be violent, but guess what? We're not the most violent gang out there. A couple towns away, there's an even more violent gang. And if we weren't here, they would come here and kill all of you. We're actually protecting you from them, so you're welcome. And once you bring the emotion of fear into it, it's over. People wouldn't be able to reason anymore, and this gang would now be there for good. Now, at this point, again, the libertarian chimes in and says, people are smarter than that. And sooner or later, somebody would stand up, if not many people, somebody would stand up and say, this is insulting. This is bribery. I don't want to live like this. I don't want to be robbed in exchange for little petty favors that could probably just as easily, if we put some thought into it, be done by the community. And I don't want to accept all of this robbery and threats just because of some scare story about some other violent gang that could come here. There's a violent gang already here. And the people would agree, and there would be an uprising, and that would be the end of it, says the libertarian. But I got some bad news. These groups of predators, the existence of which has apparently never even occurred to the people who want to live in some kind of libertarian utopia, they've got one more trick up their sleeve, in the worst case scenario, and this one is a doozy. Now for this last one, you'll have to bear with me, because this sounds so ridiculous and far-fetched, I'm not even exactly sure how this would come to be. But imagine this. The thugs somehow convince the people to surrender control of the channels of information, communication, and education to the gang itself. Again, I don't know how that happens, but in the worst case scenario, you have to think that it could be possible. Maybe they go after the children. Yeah, they bribe parents. People are already used to bribes with free daycare. I know it doesn't sound like something that good people would allow to happen, but if enough time had passed, these people would have become pretty habituated to dependence on the gang. As daycare becomes more sophisticated and better funded, the children are forced to stay there longer and longer. They are fed a new language and subsequently a new way of thinking about the predators. Instead of describing the relationship accurately with words like theft and threats, they're given new words that distort reality. First couple generations, it might be tough, but after that, the kids would come home, they would complain, they would talk about how terrible it is, they would talk about how much it sucks, and the parents could just dismiss it by saying something like, hey, we all have to do it. And even though this worst-case scenario, I admit, is very far-fetched, the libertarians at this point would have to admit that within a generation or two, the violent predators would have no more significant problems managing their herds of peaceful and productive people. They might have to deal with the occasional rogue who questions their authority or their legitimacy, but probably not even directly. After a while, the indoctrinated people would do that for them. They would say, without the violent gang, which, and it wouldn't be called that anymore, they would have thought of a new name for it, who would maintain order? Who would take care of the children? Who would protect us from violent people who want to do us harm? Who would keep our food supply safe? As my worst case scenario vision of this anarchistic world grows even darker, other groups of thugs recognize the success that this gang has had and they copy that model. It is replicated all over the world. Even as their control over the people stabilized, the gangs would still be plenty violent. They would fight with each other. Here's a really sad thing. Because of the messages that all the people were absorbing in daycare, they would actually cheer when the gang that preys on them slaughters a group of people that another gang preys on. It could get that bad. But if this got bad enough and continued long enough, the entire world would just become divided up into these gang territories. And at this most tragic ending, a good person, a hardworking and peaceful person who just wanted to live his or her life free of coercion, would realize that there is no place on earth that they could go. The end. Wait a minute.
You know what I've just heard in the report and what I've quickly read in a few news reports? The agency is not yet confirming or denying the authenticity, so I've got to put that out there. Now, if what I have read is true, then this seems to be an incredibly damaging leak in terms of the tactics, techniques, procedures, and tools that were used by the Central Intelligence Agency to conduct legitimate foreign intelligence. In other words, it's made my country and my country's friends less safe.
Bullshit propaganda, motherfucker.
What do you do about the issue of people inside the intelligence community? As Mark was saying, there are 800,000 with top security clearance here, 21,000 in the CIA alone. Someone, somewhere, got hold of these documents and decided to pass them on. How do you ever stop that happening?
Yeah, that appears to be the story, Caddy. I don't want to jump to
conclusions. And the CIA.
Let's see how this plays out. There are other possibilities, but let's take that as our working hypothesis. And you've raised an incredibly difficult question. Number one, just the sheer number, as Mark's pointed out. How do you make sure every one of them was and remains, which may be the problem from time to time, a loyal American or a loyal member of British security services and so on? Beyond that, Caddy, there.
Okay, I have to fucking jump in there. A loyal member? This is about the CIA information that was leaked, and WikiLeaks has only released 1% of it, at least last I heard. I don't know if they released any since then. But a loyal American? Wouldn't a loyal American be the one to come out and release the documents and say how you fuckheads who are only supposed to be operating overseas, who weren't even supposed to be a permanent organization, you were supposed to fucking only be around for a certain amount of time, and the Cold War is over. I don't know if that was one of the reasons why. I don't know what the whole plan was with the CIA as far as how long they wanted them to be around. But that never happens in government. Once it's an organization, it's not going anywhere. But this is propaganda to demonize WikiLeaks and people that snitch on the government. I shouldn't even say snitch because they're not snitching. The government are the ones that are the fucking criminals.
There's another dynamic at work here. In order to do this kind of stuff, we have to recruit from a certain demographic. And I don't mean to judge them at all, but this group of millennials and related groups simply...
Which is why they want to collect all this information on kids. Another reason. All the information they're collecting, not just on people in general, but your whole life now. If you're a kid, if you're born now or were in the past, you know, 5 to 10 years, your whole life is in a database. So don't think they aren't looking at that as trying to find who to recruit for to work for the government.
They have different understandings of the words loyalty and secrecy and transparency than certainly my generation did. And so we bring these folks into the agency, good Americans all, I can only assume. But again, culturally, they have different instincts than the people who made the decision to hire them. And we may be running into this different cultural approach that we saw with Chelsea Manning, with Edward Snowden, and now perhaps with a third act.
Cultural approach, is that what it is? That's what you call it? It's culture. It's not that the government is doing illegal shit and they're wrong and somebody wants to fucking let the people know what the fuck is going on. That's a cultural thing? The fuck it is. So if it's a cultural thing, what you're saying is that your generation was obedient and stupid and didn't care what the government did. I think it's just more that the government is, well, no, I don't. They're doing just as many fucked up things as they've done. The only difference now is that the technology's there.
Actor. The liberal and conservative perspectives are fundamentally different than the libertarian perspective, which is really unique. Liberals and conservatives are at some level the same. My name is Jeff Myron, and I'm Director of Undergraduate Studies in the Department of Economics at Harvard University. I'd like to talk just a little bit about what it means to be a libertarian. I think at the most fundamental level, it means that you have a lot of respect for individual decisions and for the ability of people to make reasonable choices and decide for themselves what is in their own interest, and you have a huge suspicion of the ability of government to make people better, to make the economy or society better, by coercing individuals to doing things that they don't want to do. And so the libertarian view does not align at all well with standard Republican views. It does not align at all well with standard Democratic views. Libertarians are against drug prohibition. They're tolerant of gay marriage. They're against severe restrictions on abortion and so on. They think individuals should be able to make all those sorts of decisions and live their lives as they want to live them. It also means that you're very skeptical of economic policy, so you're a fiscal conservative. You think that most of the things governments spend money on are spent interfering with free markets, interfering with individual decisions, impeding people's ability to just live their lives the way they want by choosing their occupations, choosing how much education, choosing where to work and whom to work for. The liberal and conservative perspectives are fundamentally different than the libertarian perspective, which is really unique. Liberals and conservatives are at some level the same. They're authoritarians. They both have views on the right way for people to run their lives, and they want to impose that on people, whereas libertarians want to let people choose for themselves how to run their lives, rather than having government tell people that there's one right way to do things and other ways that are not legitimate.
There's one crucial difference between American libertarianism and traditional libertarianism. Traditional libertarianism was opposed to any form of dominance and hierarchy. One of the slogans was, no God, no master, meaning no ecclesiastical dominance, no masters in industry and personal life and families anywhere else. American libertarianism is quite different. It's perfectly happy to support masters. In fact, it extols them. It's in favor of it. It wants no interference with the domination and control of people in the workforce, let's say. That's very counter to traditional libertarianism, either in Europe or, for that matter, in the United States. If you go back to the 19th century, early days of the Industrial Revolution, there were mass popular movements which had their own journals. You can read what they said and so on. And they were just spontaneous. They were opposed to the way in which the industrial system was forcing them to turn into tools of production under.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And thank you for tuning in for this special Monday night edition of the show. We are talking about government and what it really is, at least my opinion of government and some of the facts about government that most people don't know. I would think a lot of people that would listen to this show would already know, but in general, that most people don't know. Before I get back to that, I wanted to mention the two stories, not really two stories, it's one story, but then a point I had about the show Cops and cops in general. So a 21-year-old pregnant woman was killed. You can go to my Facebook pages and the government police or the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Facebook page and read. I posted two articles that you can read about this. Now, in one of them, supposedly it was a drug raid or they were serving a drug warrant. I assume a no-knock drug warrant. They had a SWAT team, and the boyfriend of hers, according to the police. Now, again, I say according to the police because that's where you're going to get the story from. No one's going to believe anybody else but the police because the other person's a criminal, and the girl who didn't do anything is dead. And people are going to say, well, she was dating a drug dealer, well, an alleged drug dealer. I think the guy has a record, but he was only 23. And obviously he didn't do anything like murder somebody or something like that. But they alleged that he shot at the cops. He grazed. They made it sound like the cops actually got shot. They didn't. It grazed one of the cops, and the other one had a vest on, which obviously SWAT team would have, and you could even see it. I mean, so who knows what the intentions were there. But see, this is a problem because you get the narrative from the police. Even if you're the media, who are you going to fucking go to? The only people that have any information are the police, and they're going to give you their narrative of what happened. And they said that she was used as a shield in one article, and that's how she got shot and killed. Now, I don't believe that. I believe that they were firing bullets and they shot and killed her. Now, maybe they shot and killed her on purpose because they felt she was a threat, even though she was unarmed. Or I'll give them the benefit of, well, I'm not giving them the benefit of the doubt because I'm already saying they're lying, but I'll give them at least the option of saying they could have shot her by accident, meaning to shoot her boyfriend, who I guess they arrested her boyfriend and her boyfriend's father, and neither of them got shot at all. So it doesn't make a lot of sense. But in general, we're getting the stories from the government. Now, don't get it wrong. Police are government. They are part of government. They are a government agency. They're individual agencies, I guess. I mean, I don't know that you call them an agency, but they're a part of government. They work for government. They work for politicians. They're the dogs of politicians. That's what law enforcement is, and they enforce the laws that the politicians fucking pass that a lot of them, I believe, are just puppets and enforcing or not enforcing, passing the laws of the powers that be. Not all, every single fucking law, but a lot of them. So this comes down to what also related to the episode that I watched of Cops, that's on almost every episode of Cops, is drugs. So because this was a drug warrant, they could have waited. First of all, they didn't even have to wait. According to a friend, or I believe it was a friend, but they were at the movies beforehand. And why did they not search the house when they weren't even there? Why not do that? Now, I don't believe they should be searching the house at all. I think that's a violation of rights, that police don't have the right to search your house under any circumstances. I don't give a fuck what the government says, and I'll get into why in a minute. And that drug should be legal because they have no business telling you what to put in your body or what you can sell, or I was going to think of a more sophisticated word, like what type of commerce you can get involved in is not the business of the government. They have no authority. That's the whole point. Their authority is based on violence and force and weapons and a bunch of fucking idiots who take orders blindly. And the more idiots they have, the better for them, because they'll blindly follow orders. None of those fuckheads, and it's not just that drug raid. I mean, who knows how many drug raids go on a day? I'm sure hundreds. There was some statistic I read in Radley Balco's Rise of the Warrior Cop, how many no-knock warrants were served 1 year, and it was like 70,000. So think of that, I'm pretty good in remembering shit. It could have been, you know, there's so many numbers I've seen, but I'm pretty sure either 2012 or 13 or something, there was a number, 70,000. And I think that was, I could be wrong, so I just want to put that out there. But I know it was a huge number. It could have been even higher. But even if it was 70,000, just 365 days in a year. Do the math. That's more than 100 a day. It's like 200 a day. So you look at this business of drugs, and it is a business, don't get me wrong. And I'm not talking about selling drugs, the business aspect of that. I'm talking about the law enforcement side of the business, the prison aspect of the business, the fucking fines for ticketing people for cannabis in a lot of states now, where they don't arrest them, but they ticket them. And even if they arrest them and they, you know, they don't go to jail, but they end up paying fines. I got the maximum fucking fine for a bullshit charge where the cops put bruises all over me because I asked them why they were asking me to get out of my car. So I obstructed their investigation of me. So they thought it would be okay to almost rip my arm out of my socket, throw me on the ground on top of rocks, and knee me in the back. Somebody who at the time was about, I was probably like 170 pounds at the time. I'm 5'11". I mean, you know, I've been in a lot of fights in my life, but when I was younger, but, you know, I was drunk, and my point being that it was pretty easy for them to subdue me at the time. I wasn't, like, you know, trying to fight them, or, you know, I was drunk, so I wasn't, like, and I wasn't, like, being a mean drunk. I was just, like, you know, somebody could have pushed me and I would have fell. So I was just questioning, which you don't do. You question them. And I had a gun put to my head. Not literally touching my head, but I mean, when they approached the car, they had a gun out and it was level with the fucking seat of the car. And I was in the passenger seat because I was drinking. And this is, what, 2012? So anyway, this is the fucking bullshit that they do. But I was watching Cops, you know, and the majority of this shit, and I talked about when I did a couple shows on Cops the past few weeks on the show Cops, you know, and of course they show all the people that talk, you know, and don't know their rights, and, you know, they're really taking advantage of these people, but they don't even care that they're arresting, you know, kids basically in their early 20s for drugs. And they act like they're doing them a fucking favor. I've heard cops say on the show how they're better off. I had a quote, I think, when I did one of the shows, either part one or part two, that a cop had said, well, they're better off in jail. Or they're either better. He had some fucked up comment. Either they're better off dead or in jail. Like, if they're not in jail or rehab or something, then they're better off dead. I don't, some fucked up comment, but essentially they talk about drug dealers like, you know, drugs are just selling themselves, meaning like, not selling themselves, like jumping into people's bodies. Like people aren't buying them. You know, people aren't putting them in their bodies, making a choice to do that. that they're poisoning people. And that's all fucking propaganda bullshit. But never mind that. They're arresting all these users. They are arresting some people that are like minor sellers. Of course, they never bust, you know, the big guys because they don't want to. That's the whole, it's a whole fucking corrupt system, and it's government that is all behind it. Because the CIA sells drugs. They want drugs to exist because they want people to use drugs. But at the same time, they want the business of law enforcement. So they want that side of it. They want to make money off it. So it's, you have all these aspects of it. But they're arresting these kids for like little bags of cocaine or little bags of crystal meth or heroin or whatever. And they're ruining their lives because they choose to do these drugs. And if they actually did research, and they don't teach the cops this shit, because, and he already said it, Dr. Carl Hart, who I did a show on, and I want to read his book first, and I want to see if he'll come on. I don't know. I mean, I have a small show, but he seems to, I mean, he's been on, like, you know, Fox News and, you know, big cable shows and stuff like that. So I don't know that he'd come on my little show, but he seems like a nice enough guy that if he has the time, maybe he would. I don't know. But, and we may disagree on some things, but when it comes to drugs, he's a neuroscientist who's been studying drugs over 25 years. And he even thought the same way, that, oh, you know, crack is poisoning my neighborhood. And he used to sell drugs and use them. But then, you know, he ended up going to college, eventually becoming a neuroscientist and studying drugs. But the reason he wanted to study drugs is he wanted to stop the use, because he thought something like crack was destroying his community. He is originally from the Miami area. And at one point he went to University of Wyoming, which I like because they're in the Mountain West Conference, and I support the Western teams and whatever. So I think they had a pretty good season last year. UNLV actually beat them, though. But they kind of imploded at the end of the season. Anyway, he's actually done real studies on drugs and the dangers, and it's all hype. It's all, now, not to say that he says drugs are good for you. However, they do have uses that help you. And he compares how a lot of prescription drugs are almost the same as some of the drugs on the street. Crack and cocaine are the same thing. They just take out one molecule so you can smoke it. Even though the penalties are stiffer for crack and things like that. Nobody gets addicted from trying something once. That's a bunch of bullshit. And this is a guy who went in, who already had that paradigm or those ideas that drugs are bad. But he was open-minded enough, even though he ran into so many obstacles. Now, he did get funding and things like that. But what he had said is most of the funding is coming from people or organizations, whether it's the government or pharmaceutical companies, or maybe it's not so much pharmaceutical companies, but organizations that want you to come to the conclusion of how bad drugs are. How crystal meth destroys your brain, which is not true. Crystal meth is like Adderall. The only thing that I throw into it, and it'd be great to have him on and ask him this, is that's assuming that you're getting the same thing and the people aren't cutting up your stuff with some shit that's not, you know, supposed to be part of it. And And, you know, probably if you got that every time, it might do damage. But that's the fault of the government making it illegal, because if it was legal, we wouldn't have that problem. And I've talked about that before, too. So, anyway, they're ruining the lives of these kids. They have no right, first of all, to search your car or to arrest you for drugs. That is kidnapping. Because just because the government makes a law doesn't mean shit. They have no authority. Their authority comes from a bunch of men with weapons and the resources they have financially from extorting us. Because if they didn't have that, they couldn't do shit. They couldn't enforce shit. So they claim the authority that, hey, we can make these laws. We have the authority to do it. But they don't. It's not authority. You have a bunch of men with guns and women that will enforce this shit for you. And you have unlimited resources because you can print as much money as you want, number one. And number two is you extort money from us the same way out of threat of force and violence. But just because a law is a law does not mean you're not having your rights violated. What right do they have to search your car or your house? They don't. And if drugs were legal, as they should be, and not just like marijuana is legal in Colorado with a million fucking, you know, regulations and all these permits and a 20% tax rate and all of this shit. No, it should be on the shelf like it used to be in the early 1900s with every fucking thing else like aspirin and acetaminophen, which is worse for you than fucking with painkillers, the ones with acetaminophen in it. And those are the ones that aren't as strong compared to like Oxycontin, the pure Oxycontin that's like goes up to, I think, 80 milligrams. But the 5 and 7.5 and 10 milligram pills of hydrocortisone or oxycodone are mixed with acetaminophen usually. Or sometimes Tylenol or what's the other one? Ibuprofen. Those are worse for you, as in my opinion. And if you look it up, I wouldn't even say that's my opinion. Now, it's debatable, just like a lot of things. But if you look at what that can do to your liver, really, the opioid part of it, the hydrocortisone, the methadone, which they give you to get off it. I don't know if methadone, yeah, it has opiates in it. Codeine, I'm trying to think of what other opioids there are. There's another one with an M. Morphine. Those, if you look at, now every drug has side effects. And I looked at like acetaminophen, Tylenol, ibuprofen compared to, you know, these opioids. And there's no, I got the impression by looking at those that over long, on a long-term use, that acetaminophen and ibuprofen are a lot worse for you. And that's the part of the pill that probably is the worst for you, that I don't know why they just don't take it out. Now, it does help with pain, supposedly, and what I read was the mixture of them helps the opioid to work better or something like that. But that's why, and they said how cotton was so bad because it was just pure OxyContin. I would say OxyContin is better for you than the ones that are mixed with acetaminophen and or ibuprofen, because you don't have that damage to your liver. I mean, you can get liver failure from acetaminophen and Tylenol and ibuprofen. The only issue with these drugs is that they are so controlled that people end up buying them on the street if they need more or they can't get any, and they spend a bunch of money, and if they can't afford it, you know, they're sitting there homeless or something like that or whatever, and the access to getting it, and then they come out and say, hey, we have a heroin epidemic, and it's caused by, you know, OxyContin. Because when OxyContin started, they said, you know, this about it and that about it, and it's not addictive and whatever. And then all these people are addicted, and it's an epidemic. And no, it's not an epidemic. There are plenty of people, not with just that drug, but this is another thing that Dr. Carl Hart had said, that the majority of people of drug users, habitual drug users, are not addicts, are not, you know, like you see these images of like crackheads on the street. And that is not the majority. That's maybe 10%, if that. And that's of the people that are habitual drug users, which is like 6% or something of the population anyway. It's such a small thing. But they, you know, they throw all this money at it, all these jobs, all this bullshit. It is so ridiculous. And it's because of the agenda behind it. And it's a big agenda. And I should probably do a show on that. But you're seeing these kids' rights being violated because it's their body. So we'll get into, from there, let me get into self-ownership. And then get back into government. So, to me, when it comes to government and all of the issues and things that I've brought up and that I will bring up, is one of the things that you would have to recognize or believe in to conceptually understand, not just understand what I'm saying, but actually believe in what I'm saying. And I'm not saying believe in when I'm talking about facts and whatever, but believe in that there shouldn't be a government, is the concept of self-ownership, because it goes, in my opinion, very closely, I think, in anybody's opinion who has the same views that I have. So self-ownership means that you own yourself. So you own your body. Nobody else does. And essentially, if you don't believe that you own your body, there's only two other answers to that, really, is, well, not really, because you could say nobody owns your body, but that's not possible in the sense that, well, okay, you don't own your body, and nobody owns your body. And what does that even mean? It would mean the same thing as you own your body if nobody else owns it, right? I would think. If you say that nobody else owns your body, you would have to. You don't have to put it in the sense of I own my body, but if nobody else owns your body, nobody else has the right to tell you what to do with it. So saying that no one owns your body is the same thing as saying that you own your body. Now, if you want to say that you don't own your body, then by default, the government owns your body, which they believe they do. And I would say that's a fact as well. And it's a fact because the government believes they can tell you what you can put in your body and what you can't. They believe they can control things like prostitution, if you want to sell your body, if you want to put drugs in your body. And there's other things that I can't think of at the moment. Oh, if you want to kill yourself, assisted suicide. And I'm not saying if you're mentally ill, which technically, even if you're mentally ill, you have the right to kill yourself. And in some ways it makes sense because you may be so mentally ill that you don't want to live with it anymore if it's something incurable. Or the medication and taking it is worse than, and I have relatives that are mentally ill, so I'm familiar with this. So now, if it's something that's just, you know, you're depressed and it's going to pass, you know, that's a little different. But at the same time, it is your body. So I'm not going to get into the specifics on that because that's a whole nother debate. But based on, you know, just looking at assisted suicide for terminally ill patients, that's illegal in most states. Drugs are, all of them are illegal in most states, except, of course, alcohol. I think 6 states, cannabis is now legal. Nevada is one of them, actually, now. I think Nevada, Massachusetts, of course, Colorado, Washington, Oregon. And I don't know if it passed in Maine. It might have not. There was one state it didn't pass in. Or maybe it was Arizona. Maybe it's Maine. That it did pass in, or Vermont. So obviously the government believes that they own you. They own your body, which they don't. And again, if when they made laws, which of course this wouldn't happen because this is not the plan of government. When they made laws, they thought about stuff like that, then laws would be a lot different. As I had said earlier, up until 1914, the government didn't tell people what they can and cannot put in their body. Now, what does that tell you? Now, to me, also, to ban alcohol, they had to do it through an amendment. To ban other drugs, they didn't. So the government violates their own laws, their own governing document, the Constitution. They violate it all the time. They have since the beginning. That's the whole thing. So going back to what I was saying earlier is that the government, you know, they start off with what they started off with. Some of it was oppressive, of course. Slavery, women didn't have the same rights as men. Now, even though I talk about today, this whole fucking thing that, you know, women are oppressed and whatever, I think is ridiculous. It wasn't always ridiculous because they were oppressed for a while, a long time, even after they got some rights. Not that they didn't have rights in the same way that obviously slaves didn't have rights, but a lot of it was cultural and kind of like, it was almost like unwritten laws, a lot of it, I believe. I mean, the right to vote was an actual law. It was a written thing. You know, women didn't have the right to vote, which is crazy. But I believe there were other things that were more like unwritten, you know, when it came to, say, jobs and businesses and stuff like that. And it's, you know, a woman's place to be at home. I personally, you know, believe that somebody should be at home if you have kids. Now, it doesn't have to be the woman if that's what you guys being the people together agree to. I think biologically, in the beginning, as babies, obviously with, you know, breastfeeding, that the child bonds more with the mother. But I think that's only in the first, you know, year or couple years. But that's just my opinion, and I believe that whatever people want to do, it's their choice. And I would stay home with, you know, if I had kids, I would stay home with the kids and let my fiance work. If that's what, well, problem is she doesn't make, I don't want to say this on the air, but, you know, I make a little more money than her. But I'm also older and I have more experience because of that, and for other reasons as well. Not because I'm a man. That's not why. We have totally different jobs. But I will say that I wouldn't mind, you know, if she made enough money to where I didn't have to work. Hey, I'd rather stay home and do my show and take care of the kids. So that really has nothing to do with what the issues with government, except for the fact, again, that, you know, from the beginning, they were oppressive in certain ways. Anyway, so government, you can go back to any time. And people talk about, well, this period was the greatest time ever, like the 50s or this period. No, they were all fucked up. You can't really go, you know, you can look at certain points and say, well, we had more freedom in this area, but less freedom in this area. Or certain people didn't have freedom in this area, but other people did. So you can't really look at any time in history where there was first of all, with government, you can't have true freedom and liberty anyway. But I don't think there was a freest time. You know, because even in the beginning, you had genders and races that were being oppressed. Now, if that applied to everybody, and you had other things that were going on as well. But I think what happened was, so you have where they started off, and then it's take more and more and more freedoms and do it over generations, do it by convincing, and do it in a way, as I mentioned earlier, convince the people. And this is really the best way to do it, even though I'm not, you know, I think it's so fucked up. But what the government, the U.S. government has been able to do is get people to love their own servitude. And there was a quote from somebody. Well, actually, I think it was in the clip I played, but he might have got that from somebody. That, you know, eventually, it was from Brett's clip that I played, but he might have got that from somebody. But that eventually the government isn't going to have to criticize people because the people are going to do that for you. Now, not meaning that the government's never going to come, doesn't have to come out and, you know, they don't attack certain groups and whatever. But the point was that if you're anti-government or you're speaking out against the government, you're going to get attacked by people that don't work for the government, that have been brainwashed into thinking that all of these things are needed, like with terrorism or with whatever. So the goal is ultimately to make everyone believe in their own servitude, to think that, yes, we need to be spied on because it keeps us safe. Yes, we need to build up the military even more. We need more police. We need to arm them with automatic weapons and tanks like they've done. It's to get people to buy into that. And not everybody is, obviously, but a certain amount of people are. But they're buying into a false pretext because all of this shit is bullshit. The other thing that the government has done is create a lot of not only propaganda, but of course false flags. Whether it's something that they've done or something that they're propagandizing and exploiting, something that actually happens, they exploit the fuck out of it. And then you have false flags where they actually, and there's ones that are documented, where they actually do it themselves. And then they use it to convince the people that we need this or we need that. There's so many things that have happened that immediately following, guess what? A bill was passed. A lot of times a bill that was rejected before. They tried to do it with guns. They tried to do it with terrorist bills, and they succeeded. After 9/11, they did it. They did a lot of shit after 9/11. They totally revamped everything. But supposedly, all of that stuff was already just sitting there. They were just waiting. Either waiting for something to happen or waiting to do something on their own. The same with Oklahoma City. They had a bill. From what I understand, it didn't pass. And then it did. I don't know if they voted on it or it just didn't make it past committee or something like that. So you can see it now more and more, especially now that we have the internet, we have all this technology, and we have a lot of leaks. Now the CIA leak, the NSA leak by Edward Snowden, that's showing that the government is spying on everything you do and collecting all that data. Why? Now, there's reasons that don't involve taking more control over the people. But I think no matter how you want to look at it, that is part of it. I think there's also other reasons when it comes to the NSA. We actually talked about this a couple weeks ago. But within that, and definitely with the CIA, is control and power. You know, some of it's the ability to blackmail Congress, but that's to get them to vote how they want, which can take away freedoms. And up their budgets and all of this shit. So you see basically, or what I see, and to me, I don't know how you can deny this, but they're putting in all the infrastructure. They're setting everything up. They have a whole bunch of executive orders that in the event of emergency, and it wasn't just one president that did them all, it was over the course of time, but in an emergency that they can basically take total control of everything, martial law, whether that's an economic collapse or whatever. They have armed the police. They have armed all of these government agencies. I mean, almost every government agency has an armed unit or armed section. They're spying on people. They're monitoring Facebook and other social media. There's so many things that they're doing to take away more and more freedoms. And the other thing that I talk about that I don't think they can complete whatever, you know, have a complete takeover until this happens, unless this is part of the complete takeover, but is that's why they want to go after guns. And they're willing to do anything. Anything. And that includes false flags, killing people, whatever, as far as I'm concerned, to get rid of guns or to get guns out of the hands of quote-unquote law-abiding citizens or people in general. So I'm going to have to continue this and do a part two, and maybe we do half of this and half of something else. But more of the focus, I think, definitely has to be on this, where along with the police, I think the most important things that are part of the government's plan, and that's indoctrination. So schools, the police is very important. Drugs and a few other things. And I think I need to get more in depth on a lot of these things and just keep trying to educate people. So we'll do a part two most likely on Thursday. Ken Shorgen is supposed to be on Wednesday, but I haven't got confirmation from him. We're going to be off tomorrow. That's why I did the show tonight instead of tomorrow. I wanted to do a show, especially since I haven't been doing as many, unfortunately. So we'll be back on Wednesday. We should be back with Ken Shorgen to talk about geopolitics and the economy. And as always, I appreciate everybody for tuning in. And I hope you have a great night. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Please check it out, and please like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong...